steak good looking. What you got cooking? How's about cooking something up with me? Hey, hey, sweet baby, don't you think maybe?
Hi there, my name's Angela McKellar. I'm the host and chef of Kick Back and Kook. Tonight we're going to be preparing good old-fashioned Southern cooking. I got a suggestion from Dana in North Augusta, South Carolina, and she said, Angela, you sound pretty Southern to me. Then you could get back to your roots and show us how to make some good old-fashioned country cooking. And I said, oh, I reckon. Why not? So tonight we're going to be making Kuntry Fried Steak. And in the South, it don't matter what it is, if it's red meat or steak. So we're having Kuntry Fried Steak with gravy. We are also going to have mashed potatoes, red-skin garlic mashed potatoes. I'll be preparing collard greens, good old-fashioned collard greens with a little bit of a twist so that they're not just your average or ordinary run-of-the-mill collard greens. And we will also be having peach cobbler for dessert. And for those of you overseas that have never had sweet tea, or those of you up north, I'm going to show you how to make the good old-fashioned house wine of the South, which is, of course, sweet tea. So without further ado, let's go on ahead and get started.
It takes about an hour to prepare collard greens, so we're going to begin our collard greens, and then we're going to fry our Kuntry Fried Steak. So, in a very large pot, you see here, I have added about maybe a tablespoon of olive oil. I turn my rear eye up to about medium-high heat, and we're going to let that get really warm. For the collard greens, you always want to have something to season it with. And so you can use a turkey neck, or you can use bacon or ham hock, whatever you'd like. But what I use is sliced pork jowl bacon. Here we have sliced pork jowl bacon. The sliced pork jowl bacon, we don't need to add salt to our collard greens because this is going to be plenty salty enough that we don't have to do that. So, going to slice this here, open it, it's stuck on there pretty good. There we go. Be very careful not to cut yourself. I took a knife skills class and almost had to drop out because I was the only one that cut myself. I was so clumsy. So I'm telling you, if I can do it, anybody can do it. So we're gonna cut around the sides here. There we go. And take our knife, our very sharp knife, as you can see here. It's cutting through it just like butter. A set of really sharp knives is a must-have in your kitchen. Probably 3/4 of a pound would be plenty.
So I've taken the meat, and you want to carefully put it in there, and then stir it around. Now we're going to turn that down to about a medium heat. And we're going to add about a teaspoon of onion, but be careful not to let this pop off.
Go ahead and stir that. Let those onions become almost translucent. We're going to add about 1/4 teaspoon of red pepper flakes. You want to add all of your spices while your oil is cooking the bacon and cooking the onions, because it will really bring out the flavor of all the spices that you put in here. But you don't want to let it get too brown or too done, because it will cause you to have a bitter flavor to your collard greens. Okay, we're going to add about 1/4 teaspoon of cumin. Stir that up really well. Wow, that smells so yummy. And maybe not even an 1/8 teaspoon, just a dash of cayenne pepper. Stir that up really well. And again, all these recipes will be in my blogs. I don't measure anything, but once I come up with the recipe to put on there, you don't have to worry. It's going to turn out perfectly when you make it. And you better send me pictures. To this, we are going to add about 1/4 cup of apple cider vinegar.
When you add the apple cider vinegar, keep your distance so that the oil doesn't pop. So we have about a quarter of a cup in there, maybe half a cup.
Oh, that smells so good.
But that vinegar can get your eyes just like a chopping an onion, so be careful. Oh, my eyes. Oh, I'm crying. It smells so good, though. So that we don't have a really strong apple cider vinegar flavor, we are also going to add about a teaspoon to a tablespoon of white granulated sugar to this mixture. And again, you want to do this while the oil is cooking everything up. So we're going to have kind of a salty, smoky, tangy flavor to our collard greens.
Beaming up the camera.
Look at that. Wow. Doesn't that look good? And remember, we've turned it down to about a medium heat. Like I've said, anytime you can find produce that has already been prepped at the grocery store, it's going to save you time in the kitchen. So, I have found the collard greens already chopped and prepared, and they are very difficult to cut up. They can be very tough on you, so it makes a whole lot of sense to get these already chopped. So, what we're going to do with this, we're going to open the bag and we're going to go on ahead, put it in a colander and wash them off again. So I have put the collard greens in my colander and I'm just going to spray these off really well. Even though they've already been cut and prepared, like I said, you always want to make sure you've done it yourself and be sure that they're clean. But we're going to let that soak for a moment. When those are done draining, we're going to add it to our pot over there. We're pouring it right on in. And so you need a really, really big pot to put these in. And they will cook down significantly, but they start off taking up a lot of room. But the reason that they take up a lot of room like this is because any leafy vegetable like this, lettuce, cabbage, it's got a lot of water in it. So you don't have to add a whole lot of water to this because it will cook down and, create its own juice. And I'm going to stir this up. It's already cooking down quite a bit, and it hasn't even been in there 30 seconds. I've added about 4 cups of water. We're just going to let this cook for a little bit on about medium heat. Now, collard greens can be a little bit on the bitter side, so it's a really good idea to do the apple cider vinegar and the sugar so that you can take away some of that bitterness. At least I think so. Look at how great that looks. I wish you could smell this. Collard greens usually smell very strong, but this smells awesome. Look at that. Unbelievable. We're going to cover it so that they cook a little bit more quickly. Now, the gadget that we are featuring today is a vegetable brush. And you need to have a vegetable brush and a dishwashing brush. Because, you know, when you're scrubbing your dishes, generally you're going to be cleaning off a dirty dish that somebody else has been eating off of, and you're just going to have germs. But the vegetable brush will clean the dirt off of your vegetables without transferring germs from one place to another. So I got this for about $2.50. They range anywhere from probably $1.99 to $3 and definitely worth the investment. I have a big pot of water coming to a boil over there, and I'm going to add a tablespoon of garlic to my water once it starts boiling with my red potatoes so that we can make our mashed potatoes. So I'm going to turn on my water and scrub these very well. Make sure we get all the dirt. So now that we're done washing these, what we're going to do is cut them up into 4 pieces each. And you want to keep an eye out for the ones that are
let me see here. You want to keep an eye out for the ones that are damaged like this, how it's got that little ridge in there, and you just want to cut that off and not even bother using that part. So we're going to take this, cut them into quarters. And now that I've got them in here again, I'm going to rinse them one more time. Now we're going to boil them in our pot of water. So I'm taking my colander over here to my pot of boiling water. You want to be very careful when you're transferring your potatoes to the boiling water. You don't want to burn yourself. So if you position yourself so that you are over here, and then you drop them and pull your hand away at the same time. Or you can just use a ladle and ladle your potatoes in there without using your hand at all. My colander is really full, so I don't want to just pour them in and risk splashing myself with the boiling water. I've added a heaping tablespoon of garlic to our boiling red potatoes. It was a 5-pound bag that I used, and I probably discarded 2 or 3 potatoes because they weren't quite up to par. So we're using about 4.5 pounds of red skin potatoes. The garlic is there in the center. I put about a tablespoon of our already minced garlic, and like I've said, so that your hands don't smell like it, and also for ease of preparation, I just buy it already prepared. And it's certainly a time saver. By the time I cook everything I've cooked, I've probably saved myself an hour in the kitchen just by buying already minced garlic. Now make sure that you're keeping an eye on your collard greens the entire time that you're doing this, and just stir them periodically to check on them and see how they're doing. So I'm going to take a towel and I'm going to lift the lid away from me so that I don't burn myself on the steam. And look at that! Oh my goodness. Even if you don't like collard greens, my goodness, this looks so good, make you want to slap your mama. Wow, that smells so good. And I'm going to use my towel to pick up the lid because it is very hot. Place it back over the top there, because collard greens can take over an hour to cook, and if you use a lid, put a lid on top of it, it'll cook a lot faster. Now you can see that our potatoes are coming to a nice boil. We're going to let them continue to boil like that until we pierce them with a potato and they're soft. So now we're going to make our Kuntry Fried Steak. What I've done is I've taken 4 cube steaks, and it says cube steaks on the package. Down here in the South, if it says steak on the package, it's steak. So I've taken 4 cube steaks and I've put it in a baking dish. And after we've put the 4 steaks inside, we're going to pour about 1/2 cup to 1 cup of Worcestershire sauce over our cube steaks. And we're going to let them marinate for about 30 minutes. After 30 minutes, we're going to flip them over to make sure that they've marinated evenly. We have finished that process here and we are ready to begin making our Kuntry Fried Steak. To get started on our Kuntry Fried Steak, what I've done is I've put about 2 tablespoons of extra virgin olive oil in a pan. I have turned my eye up to about medium heat, and the reason for that is you don't want to have it on too high of a heat because you don't want the Kuntry Fried Steak to cook too quickly, and you also don't want any remaining flour to sit on the bottom of the pan and burn, because we are going to be making gravy with what's left over, and if you allow it to burn, then you don't have anything to make gravy with. So we're going to let that come to about a medium heat, and you see it moves like water when it's warm enough. See that? Another way that you can test to see if it's done is you kind of sprinkle some flour in there and see if it bubbles up, and if it does, you're ready. So to our flour here, we're adding some cracked pepper. Try to stir that up. We can always add more at the table if people like theirs to have a little bit more. We're going to take the Kuntry Fried Steak, the cube steak, our southern steak, and we're going to dredge it here in flour. And don't be afraid to get your hands dirty.
thing that I love about being in the kitchen is you can be a kid again. You can get your hands dirty and you can create things and it's just a blast. Any places you miss, just kind of sprinkle some flour on there like so. There's a place on the underside here that got missed. There's another one. And then shake off the excess. And then just slowly put it in the oil so that you don't burn yourself. And never leave frying oil unattended because it can splash onto your eye and catch fire. That is doing very nicely. We're going ahead and dredge the rest and put it in there like that. That's frying very nicely. What I'm going to do is I'm going to heat our oven to about 200 degrees. You always want to make sure everything is served at the table hot at the same time. The best thing to do is to go on ahead and prepare it and then put it in a 200 degree oven until you're ready to serve it. And that's after you've fried it. The Kuntry Fried Steak will get cold if we just leave it off to the side while we're making our gravy. So what I've done is I've taken a baking dish. You want to spray it with a nonstick spray so that it doesn't get too, so that it doesn't stick to the pan. And when we're done frying this up, we're going to put it in that pan, then stick it in the oven while we make our gravy. Now you can tell that it's about ready to flip when you see the juice starting to come up on the steak like that. See how well it's browning? Doesn't that look gorgeous? That's perfect. It's very delicate from where it's been marinating, so you probably want to try to flip it with a spatula rather than a fork or something like that. We've added about half a cup of milk to our pan, and we've deglazed the bottom of the pan, which means that we've used a liquid to get all of the bits and pieces off of the bottom of the pan. And what we're going to do is we are going to transfer that liquid into another pot. And we're going to let that heat up to about medium heat. When you see it start to steam like it's doing right now, we're going to slowly add flour to thicken it and make a gravy. It has come to a slight boil, and we turn the heat down to between a simmer and a medium. So you want to constantly whisk as you slowly add flour. Just add a tiny bit at a time and whisk very fast so that you get all the lumps out. And make sure when you whisk that you are getting the bottom of the saucepan so that none of those bits are sticking to the bottom. I'm going to add another heaping teaspoon, a little bit at a time. Now, if you don't like white gravy, even though Kuntry Fried Steak is typically served with a white gravy, you can turn it to brown gravy by using a product called Kitchen Bouquet. It is in your gravy mix aisle, and it has a little bit of a seasoning to it, and it will turn your gravy to a dark brown. That is strictly a personal preference, of course. Add another heaping teaspoon of flour slowly. Whisk it as we add it. It's starting to thicken up very nicely. We're just going to continue to whisk until all the lumps are out. Look at that! Almost done. Now if you find that you have a lot of lumps and you're having trouble getting them out, you can add a little bit more milk. And that should help you get those lumps right on out. And the longer you cook your gravy, the thicker it will get. So don't worry about it being too thin. That was pretty darn good to me. We're going to turn that down to a simmer. I'm going to turn the inside of my pot inwards towards the center of the stovetop so that I don't walk by and knock it off in the floor. Another thing is, if you've got these handles facing outwards towards the kitchen, you can have a little one
come up behind you and think that's a toy and try to grab it off the stove. And next thing you know, they're covered in hot gravy. So be sure that you face that inwards. We're going to leave that there to simmer. Our oven, like I said, is on 200, and we've got our Kuntry Fried Steak in the oven, just keeping warm, just kind of hanging out, waiting for us to finish with everything else. So I'm going to go ahead and drain this, and we'll make our mashed potatoes. Notice that when these are done and you pierce them, the fork goes right through, and they almost flake apart. That is a perfectly done potato, and that is what you're looking for.
What I've done is I've drained them, and I reserved about a tablespoon of the liquid that they were cooking in because they were cooked in garlic, and I wanted to have a nice garlic flavor.
Now I've added about an eighth of a cup of half and half, and half a stick of butter, and I've added some freshly ground pepper. You want to taste your mashed potatoes to see if they need salt. I'm going to add about half a teaspoon of salt. Remember, people at the table can always salt them, but you can't take it away. So always err on the side of caution in case you have a guest that doesn't really like salty food. And you can see, wow, the skins are so tender. Look at how creamy those are. Doesn't that look great? These are a lot of mashed potatoes, but Southern boys like their meat and potatoes. Put them in the microwave to set so that they're not exposed to cold air.
Now, to make sweet tea, this is the easiest thing on the planet to make. I take 3 family-style tea bags here. Now, I take them and I put them in my coffee maker. And I have the tea bags hanging over the edge, and then I just close it up. It's filled up with one entire pot of water. So I just turn that on, and it's going to brew that, a very concentrated tea, in my coffee pot. Now for our peach cobbler, this is so simple, you're just not even going to believe it. We are taking 2 cans of peaches, about 15 ounces each, 2 cans of peaches drained with about a tablespoon of the syrup reserved and used in here. I'm going to use a lot of cinnamon, and I just stir that around really well to make sure that the cinnamon evenly coats our peaches here. And then I add about a quarter of a cup of sugar and stir that around. You don't want so much sugar. Yeah, that looks great. I have a cup of sugar, a cup of white granulated sugar, and a cup of all-purpose flour. I'm adding about a teaspoon of my Ceylon cinnamon, and I'm also going to add a half a stick of butter. Make sure it is not room temperature or it will not work. It has to be cold right out of the refrigerator. Now the gadget that we are using today is a pastry blender. You hold it in your hand like this and you just push down on your butter, cinnamon, and sugar mixture. We're going to push down into our butter. Now, it will have a tendency to move up on your pastry blender, so you just want to periodically take a spatula and get the excess off. Like I said, you want to make sure that the butter is straight out of the refrigerator. If not, it isn't going to work right. You're looking for a very crumbly mixture, and if you allow the butter to melt at all, you will end up with a paste instead of crumbly topping. We're making a very crumbly topping for our peach cobbler. Look how unbelievably easy this is. And just in a downward motion, press from the edges inward, edge of the bowl inward. Now this makes a lot of topping. You can use as much or as little as you like. You're going to preheat your oven to 350 degrees. Right now we have our Kuntry Fried Steak in there, keeping warm, just kind of hanging out, waiting for us to get hungry enough. But this crumbly mixture is what you're looking for. That's perfect. See that? It's going to caramelize and brown on top of our peach cobbler. And here's our peaches.
And we have this crumbly mixture to put on top of our peaches. Looks like we've slaved over this peach cobbler. And I like a lot of topping on mine. So to make sweet tea, I have about a cup of sugar. For a pitcher this size, this is going to hold about probably 8 cups of liquid. I'm going to fill it half full of the concentrated tea. And then I'm going to stir it very well to dissolve the sugar. And you want to be careful not to add too much sugar while the tea is hot, because as it cools, it will get sweeter. We're going to add cold water the rest of the way. And Southerners drink it right out of the tap. Don't be too proud. I'm going to stir that up really well. And this is about the color. I might want it a little bit darker than that. So I add a little bit more tea. There we go. That's perfect. That's the color you want it to be. A nice caramel brown color. And you have to have lemon with sweet tea. Sweet tea is just not sweet tea without your lemon. I'm going to pour that in there. Doesn't that look good? And folks, there you have it. We have got our Kuntry Fried Steak with gravy, garlic, red skin, mashed potatoes, collard greens, and sweet iced tea.
Very, very nice presentation.
Is it good?
It's very good. It is very good.
All right, honey, try the collard greens.
Man, this is really good.
Is it good?
Those are good collard greens.
Yeah?
This is excellent.
Now I'm going to, you see it's bubbling very nicely, very brown on top. That's exactly what you want it to look like. Now we've let it cool for about 2 minutes. Good?
It's very good.
That's very good.
Thank you so much to Dana in North Augusta, South Carolina for suggesting Rebel with a Cause. Tonight's dinner was a fantastic success, and I know that if you try it at home, you'll have the same success that I've had tonight. If you do try it, please send me your picture. I'm going to finish up my peach cobbler, and I look forward to seeing you for Angie Wonka and the Dessert Factory for episode 4. Thanks so much for tuning in, and I'll see you next time.
From Memphis, Tennessee, my home is on the south side, high up on a ridge, just a half a mile from the Mississippi.